faces and some new faces as well. My name is Nancy Kistner. I am the chair of the Center for Financial Planning's Women's Initiative, which got started about 4 years ago. So this is a very special day for many of us that are in the room. I'm also a very proud CFP professional of 23 years. I'm coming up on number 24 in a month. And it's pretty amazing. I have to say, I never thought I would actually acquire this certification and then join this community that has grown over time. I had no idea whatsoever. So it's pretty incredible and feels great. So today we're launching the I Am a CFP Pro campaign. It's really a launch to build awareness of the CFP certification among millennials, women, and people of color. So this goes well beyond our women's initiative that we started, and it's expanded to a diverse population of CFP professionals. But more than that, this campaign was designed to spread the message that the future of financial planning depends on the participation of these communities in order to grow, thrive, and remain responsive and relevant to the public that it serves. The campaign has been long in the dreaming and the making, and there are women in this room who are CFP professionals that helped bring this dream to life. 4 years ago, we launched the Women's Initiative. It's also known as WIN, just to keep it simple. And it was really to address the fact that only 23% of the CFP population was comprised of women CFP professionals. Pretty amazing, right? It actually is, because being one of those women and knowing that there's lots of women in this room and on the webcast and outside and in states across this country who are so successful as CFP professionals, it's hard for us all to believe that there still are only 23% of us representing the CFP population. So to tackle this issue, we formed a WIN Advisory Council to conduct research around this feminine famine, as we call it, and to develop recommendations for building greater gender diversity in the financial planning profession. The council's research showed that women, more so than men, really had no idea about financial planning, not much at all, and they certainly didn't know what a financial planner did. And if they even thought about it, they thought it involved math, analytics, numbers, sales, things that most women weren't necessarily interested in. Not that there aren't women who are strong at math and analytics, but they were interested in other things as well. They didn't recognize that financial planning can be a great career for women. I certainly can attest to that. They didn't realize that there's an art and a science to financial planning, that you build relationships alongside planning a family's future, which really ties into what's important to women, financial security. That leads me to this campaign. To address this lack of awareness and the misperceptions of women, the council considered what we called a Faces and Voices of Women CFPs campaign. And the idea was, we thought if women heard our stories, they could then identify with becoming a financial planner. Well, this concept of a Faces and Voices campaign to attract more women to the profession was later revised, and instead of just tackling that challenge, we had to take on more, of course, because that's what we do. So we decided we wanted to meet the mission of the Center for Financial Planning, which is to create a diverse and a sustainable workforce, and not just by increasing women who are CFP professionals, but also people of color and millennials. Why not bring all of that into the mix and make what we do as a profession relevant to people? So with this bigger agenda at stake, the center then began to do some serious research. We looked for the right PR teams, diversity experts, and spokespeople who could really bring color, energy, passion into what was once just a good idea in a council meeting to a large-as-life multimedia representation of what it means to be a CFP pro, as well as a woman, a person of color, or a millennial. So this indeed is an exciting day for me and my colleagues at the Center of Financial Planning to welcome you to this launch of the I Am a CFP Pro campaign. What you will see and hear today will amaze you. It's amazing to know that there are three individuals that represent other individuals of CFP professionals who are bringing the financial planning community together. And it's also the future of financial planning for us, and they're great representatives of it. So you will understand, too, why diversity, racial, gender, and generational is such an important component of a strong financial planning profession prepared to meet the future. So it's now my pleasure to introduce to you Blaine Aiken. If you don't know Blaine, he is our current chair of the CFP board, and I've had the pleasure of working with Blaine when I served as chair of the CFP board in 2013, which is the same year our WIN initiative launched. I want to thank Blaine for his support of WIN and most certainly for his leadership of CFP board. So with that, please join me in welcoming Blaine Aiken.
Well, hello. I certainly want to join Nancy in welcoming everyone here today on behalf of CFP Board, everybody who's here in Washington, D.C., and all those who are joining from around the country to join in this festive event that we have here today. As Nancy mentioned, this campaign really is something that's been long in the making, and it's an exciting time to bring this all together. It's a culmination of a lot of hard work that was put in on behalf of the CFP Board Center for Financial Planning and our many volunteers, as well as the generous supporters, both from a corporate perspective and individual donors as well. It's truly a historic moment, not only for the center, but also for the financial planning profession as a whole. It was, I think, just over a year ago that the center was just a concept, but now it really has taken on a new life, and it's a vision that is being fulfilled for CFP Board as a whole. So, you know, the CFP Board's Board of Directors wanted to address some of the most pressing challenges that we have in the financial planning profession as a whole. So today, the center is very much real. It's making significant headway through programs such as the campaign that you're going to see today. And before we unveil that program, we do want to take a few moments to speak with you about how the work of the campaign fits into the center's vision and mission overall. Today, and if we could, I think, advance to the next. So today, more than 40% of Americans do work with financial advisors, and that is compared to just 28% in 2010. This growth reflects really increasing demand for personal financial planning services. However, as we know, the financial planning workforce is both aging and it's shrinking. So it's becoming increasingly difficult to keep up with the demand that we're experiencing. There are currently more CFP professionals who are over 70 than are under 30, and nearly 20% of the financial planning workforce is approaching retirement. So in addition, as we know, the current workforce lacks diversity. Women make up just 23% of current CFP professionals, and people of color represent significantly less than that. We do expect that the U.S. will be a majority minority nation by 2043, and our profession is really not on track to meet this, the population that it must serve, really, to be relevant going forward. The center's mission overall is to create a more diverse and sustainable financial planning profession so that every American has access to competent and ethical financial planners. Simply put, This is still a young profession, which was pioneered by many of you who are in this room today, and also individuals, I'm sure, that are joining us via the webinar. So in that sense, in this being such a young profession, it's important for us to maintain relevance and to be more relevant by making sure that we unite and address the critical challenges that the profession is facing today. The CFP Board Center for Financial Planning is tackling these various challenges head on by convening all stakeholders in the profession to conduct research and launch programs like the I Am a CFP Pro campaign. We intend to make a big difference with respect to attracting the next generation of financial planners. The center is already underway with a robust agenda of initiatives spanning the three focus areas: workforce development, diversity, and the academic home. Our workforce development initiative is focused on attracting and developing the next generation of financial planners to replace the retiring workforce. As part of that effort, we are expanding our career center, establishing new scholarships for students studying towards CFP certification, and establishing internship programs for professionals seeking to return to the workforce. Our diversity initiative will address the lack of gender and racial diversity within the profession through efforts such as the Women's Initiative, our mentorship program for women, and our upcoming study to examine barriers to racial and ethnic diversity in the profession, and that study will be coming out next year. The I Am a CFP Pro campaign is very much a part of both the workforce development and the diversity initiatives. And lastly, the Academic Home Initiative is tackling the dire shortage of qualified faculty to teach financial planning in the colleges and universities, as well as the need to build a respected and established body of knowledge. I invite everyone who's joining us here today to make a personal commitment of your time, your talent, and your treasure to be a part of the I Am a CFP Pro campaign and the center's grand challenge to create a more diverse and sustainable financial planning profession. We're confident that the center will elevate financial planning to the same level of recognition that's experienced in other disciplines like accounting and medicine and law. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Marilyn Mormon Gillis, who's the executive director of the Center for Financial Planning and who's going to unveil the campaign, I Am a CFP Professional. All right, thank you. Please join me in welcoming Marilyn.
Thank you, Blaine, and welcome, everyone. As Blaine said, I'm Marilyn Mormon Gillis, and I'm the executive director for the Center for Financial Planning. And I'm very, very pleased to have all of you here today. First, I would like to extend a very special thanks to our lead founding sponsor, TD Ameritrade Institutional, and we have Kate Healy in our audience today, so thank you to Kate. And also to our founding sponsor, Northwestern Mutual, and we have Jennifer Brassi from Northwestern Mutual who's with us today, so thank you. So now it's time for the big reveal. And we are so thrilled to show you our I'm a CFP Pro campaign. This campaign is really a multifaceted campaign that seeks to tell the stories of CFP professionals through a series of storytelling videos, also through a robust and interactive website, through engagement, through social media, and through outreach through a series of toolkits for all of those who want to become engaged in this campaign and help us spread the story. So to tell us these stories, we have selected three outstanding young CFP professionals who are really the future of the financial planning profession: Brittany Castro, Justin Sullivan, and Rianca Dorsenville. You will get to meet them in just a few minutes, but I want to let you know that they were chosen from over 250 individuals who applied to be part of this campaign. We were looking for CFP professionals who had a distinct online presence, who were known to the profession, but I think most importantly, who really demonstrated sincere passion for the profession, and we found them in our CFP pros. Before we go to the videos, though, let me say a few words about our website. Our campaign website is cfppro.org, and it will be the go-to destination. Now, I say will be because, unfortunately, we have a few technical difficulties right now, but I assure you it will be up and running very, very soon. But this new website is chock full of information about why a CFP professional is a great career for young people. From the storytelling videos to facts and figures about the profession, it doesn't just give you information, but it really engages you. And so I want everyone to know, whether you are an aspiring CFP professional, whether you're a current CFP professional, whether you're in a firm somewhere across the country, or you're in our colleges and universities who are providing programs, there's a place for each of you on the website. For those of you interested in the profession, you can go and learn more about it. You can download a guide, you can register, or you can join our online site with people like you who are thinking about joining the profession. If you're a current CFP professional, you can go to the website and tell your story. And hopefully you will be inspired by the stories today to log on and to use our hashtag CFP Pro to tell your story about why you love being a CFP professional. If you're one of our schools, our colleges or universities across the country, and you want a great recruiting tool for your students, you can go to our website and we have a toolkit for you. And if you're with any of our firms across the country and you want more people in your workforce, please go to our website because you will find a toolkit just for you to reach out to that workforce. So now it's time to show you the centerpiece of the campaign, the storytelling videos. We have three videos, and we're going to show you each one of them. We have the long version, which we're going to show you today, which is about 2 minutes. We also have a 30-second version and a 15-second version that we can use on social media. So the first video features Brittany. The second video features Rianca, and the third video features Justin. So join with me in enjoying these videos.
There's so much transformation that occurs in one's life when they get their finances in order. This feeling like, yeah, their relationships get better, they're way more excited about their futures. It's a great feeling because I really just know I help them get there.
Cool. I look so LA.
It's maybe the financial planner in me, but I always like to check all my own accounts every morning. You know, it's funny, I never thought I was gonna be a financial planner. Like, I really didn't even know that was a career. I'm not up at 6 a.m. watching the stock market. Ultimately, what we're doing is helping people budget, plan, save, invest wisely. On the first call that I have with potential clients, I remind them that it can be scary, and it's really courageous when people open up and share that, as it helps me advise them even better. So many people come to me, and it really is the first time where they feel like, oh, I trust you. This is exactly what financial planning is. It's that ability to trust somebody to help you navigate your finances in a way that you can use your money to serve you and the goals you have. This never works. Have you ever tried this? There's never money left over, right? We always have money to spend. I always knew if I'm gonna be taken serious in this business, I better get my CFP designation. I wanted to let people know I'm in it for the right reasons. I'm in it for the long haul.
CFP degree, equally important, equally proud accomplishments I've done.
Once you know what you're investing in and you understand investment strategies, it'll be so much easier to stay the course and not worry about what the stock market is doing any given day. I think if you have that feeling in you, like, yeah, I could be a financial planner, do it, because we need more financial planners and it's such a great career. You're helping people with their money, you can make good money, and you have ultimate freedom over your time. So that's, you know, win-win-win.
I'm Brittany Castro, and I'm a CFP professional.
I love being a CFP professional because I am making a tangible impact in individuals and families every single day.
I am looking over my calendar. I have quite a few meetings today. Let's talk about the B word. Let's talk about the budget.
And I love to help my clients achieve their goals.
We're pinky promising that we're gonna get it. You got it? All right. So I love having a virtual firm because I could literally work from anywhere on the planet.
Being a financial planner, it allows you to build the work-life balance that you want. It really depends on the life you want to live and the balance that you want to have. So really, it's up to you.
My very, very favorite certification is my Certified Financial Planner certification. I passed it and it was the second most happiest day of my life. The first one was when I married my best friend.
The financial planning profession, it's more than just about numbers. Actually, it's about building relationships.
So I'm about to meet with my mentee. So I'm a mentor to a younger financial planner in the profession.
I really appreciate it. If it wasn't for you, I wouldn't become a CFP. I just became one in August, so yeah.
Yeah, congratulations.
Professionals who are interested into transitioning into the financial planning profession, or students who want to have a fulfilled career. And when you wake up every day, that you're living the life that you want to live, and then ultimately bettering our society, then this is the career that they want to have.
I've been able to expose my family and my community to what is a CFP professional, what we do.
And especially with my Nana, she didn't have the financial knowledge. And so when it came time for her to spend the last golden years of her life, so to say, just relaxing, she was ill and sick and worried about finances. At that point in time, I vowed and dedicated my career to her so that another family do not have to witness that when it comes to finances. That's why. My name is Rianca Dorsonville, and I am a CFP professional.
I truly believe that the clients I work with have selected me not so much because of my ideas and the solutions that I placed in front of them, but it's because they trust me and they like me and they like to work with me. Typical day in my life. Wake up, take care of my dog, try to get in some kind of fitness.
A lot of times thinking about what the markets are doing, what they've done overnight, how they impact the client's portfolio and what I need to communicate to them.
They're deciding to bring you into their life to be responsible for what is most precious to them. The work that I do and the way that it benefits communities is multifaceted. I think we take for granted what people know, especially when you talk about groups that have historically not been exposed to wealth. And then also, I think giving back, it just kind of flows naturally, whether it's related to financial planning or not, just giving back to your community. You start to have conversations with people and they start to look up to you.
The more I converse with individuals, it's not common knowledge that there's kind of the good debt and the bad debt. But your mortgage is a good thing, your student loans are a good thing. I shouldn't call them good things. The owing money is never like a great thing, but the good kind of debt that you want to have.
A CFP professional comes in a variety of different flavors. Me, for example, I wear a suit and tie every day to work. I meet with high net worth professionals and I specifically provide investment advice.
My career would not be where it is without the CFP. Thankfully, a mentor recommended I pursue it many years ago. I'm so thankful for her because it instilled so much trust in the relationship I have with my clients, and even my colleagues trust me more, especially when you're younger. They think maybe you're a little inexperienced, but the CFP helped me tremendously.
It's made me incredibly marketable because people automatically know that I've completed a rigorous program.
I kind of think about my role in three different parts. There's compliance, so I have to make sure things are done properly and ethically. There's a part that is about building new relationships and winning new clients. But what I like best is the client experience.
My job is really rewarding in that I know I'm making a difference in the lives of my clients and their families. I'm Justin Sullivan, and I'm a CFP professional.
So I'd like you to please join me again in thanking our CFP professionals for telling such passionate and unique stories about what it means to be a CFP professional. Thank you. So it's now my pleasure to turn the program over to Eleanor Blaney. Eleanor is our special advisor on gender diversity, and she's going to help you get to know Justin, Rianca, and Brittany just a little bit better.
Thank you, Marilyn. I have a secret to share with you. I've always wanted to dance with the stars, but talking with them is going to be just as much fun. Our stars and the future of our industry. So great to have you here. Okay. Well, what I'd like to do today, I have kind of my questions. I want to address three things, three buckets, and hopefully we'll get to all of them. But one is just to talk a little bit about, you know, what it means to get the CFP and what you know, how do you do it, and the actions that you took going after that prestigious certification. Secondly, I want to talk a little bit about the experience, and I know you shared some of this on the videos, but you know what it's like to be across the table from a client. What are the things you talk about? What's important to them? And then I also want to talk about diversity, because you represent truly, as Blaine was saying, you know, our industry has to change to look like the America we're going to serve. And you three are representatives of what that future will look like and needs to look like. So I want to talk about your unique status as representing these various what unfortunately now are minorities in our profession. So we'll talk about that and lots of other things. So with that, let's go. Okay, let's talk a little bit about, go back to the time when you were first heard, or when did that decision to get the CFP really crystallize in your mind? And what were the factors that you weighed when you did that? Justin, I'm going to start with you.
Yeah, I'll kick us off. When I was a student in college, I was very ambitious, and I had summer internships. I'd got the job that I was going to start my career in, and when I got there, I realized I was in a very competitive situation. I wanted to advance, but the people who were my peers had a lot more experience than I did. They were a lot more credentialed than I was. And so what happened is once I learned and educated myself about the CFP, I finally saw a light at the end of the tunnel. I figured this could be the path that can allow me to be really taken seriously and really advance in my career. So that was the moment that I first got started. It was like, okay, I'm a rookie and I need to do something to establish myself. CFP was the answer.
You mentioned mentorship in your video. That was an important part too?
That was a really big part of it. Yeah, it's important. I mean, you've got to have someone who's guiding you along. I think, unfortunately, younger people who are not have not been exposed to the profession, are unaware of the pathways, and having a mentor is a perfect example of how you can be educated and informed.
Right. Rianca, you talked about your Nana and how that was a very powerful force in your decision. But when did you decide to, you knew that you had to feel comfortable with finances, but when did you decide to go for the CFP?
was, I would say, probably during my internship, and I saw the impact and the knowledge that the financial advisors were sharing with the clients, and just the different facets of the personal finance and the depth of knowledge that they had, that they were able to share to clients. And so I said, well, if I'm going to pursue this career, I'm going to go for the gold standard. I'm going to go for the CFP. And so it was at that moment I knew that was just the most logical next step for me. I didn't know when I was going to take it, but I knew that it was a goal of mine in my career.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk a little bit about what you had to do to get that once you were decided and you started towards a certification. Let's talk a little bit about what was involved. I mean, after all, the requirements for the CFP certification are pretty rigorous. You know, that's actually a big part of why it is such a desirable, prestigious, top of mind for the consumer designation. But there are education requirements, there are examination requirements, and there are experience requirements. So, Brittany, how did you, and you know, a lot of CFPs I know, like, do I work and get, I mean, how do you put all that together? Did you have a plan for how you were going to address the various components of the certification?
Yes. Well, first of all, hi, everyone, and hi to the live streamers. So exciting to be here.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yes, I'm a planner, so of course I had a plan. I probably had too many plans with the CFP. Actually, it was a few years into being a financial advisor that I decided to become a CFP, and it was one of those decisions like I wanted to be credible, I wanted my clients to take me serious, and also looking so young right out of college, I was like, gosh, I gotta show up to these meetings with something to like say, no, I'm legit, I'm serious. So when I made that decision, yeah, I basically mapped out a year of my life to really diving into the curriculum. I kind of didn't mess around. I expedited it as much as I could, and I did work at the same time. And I made sure that for the 6 months leading up to the exam, I was like a hardcore studier, you know, like I took every review course possible because I knew if I'm going to do this, I really don't want to do it again. So I wanted to pass the first time. And it was worth it because it did work out that way, and it was great.
Right, right. So actually, I was talking to Rianca and Justin before the meeting, and you want to share your exam stories?
Yeah.
And I think it's important to hear that there is life after not passing
yes,
the first time.
Yes, yes.
So
the CFP curriculum is diverse, and it requires a strong depth of knowledge across different areas. And at that point in my career, which is still today, I'm an investment professional. My focus is on the investment side. So I was weaker in some of the other categories. And so I remember the day I came home and got the envelope, and it was, I did not pass. I think I just went to sleep. It was probably like 5:30. It was like 5:30 p.m. one day, and I was just like, I'm done. Because in all transparency, my employer had paid for it. I had also done a fast track version of that program, so I had time off of work that was approved to do that, and people were asking, you know, like, hey, did you pass? It was miserable. So what I did was I decided to go to work a couple hours early every day after that, that was where I found the best study time for me. It was in the morning before my day got started. By the time people started coming into the office, I just closed it. I didn't really talk to people about it, and then once I passed the second time, then I told everybody about it.
Rianca, what do you have to say?
Well, my experience was a little different because I went through the CFP Board Register program at Virginia Tech. And so it was like a cohort of us coming out feeling, you know, just so ambitious and just like, hey, yeah, let's all take the exam together. And so it was kind of like peer pressure.
Oh, yeah.
Of taking the exam together. But and also at this time, I was moving to a new area. I was planning a wedding. And so I was doing all of this, but of course, I think I'm superwoman and can study for this exam and also move and then also plan a wedding and still pass the exam. It was a wake-up call that no, you know, we need to take this exam. It's, you know, a little bit more seriously. And so I didn't pass the first time. Again, just like Justin, I got that envelope and I think I slept for the entire weekend because it was just, it's a lot that you put into that you invest. And so what I share, and I don't mind sharing my story because what I share with my mentees now, if they do not pass the first time, is that, you know, everyone is in a different space in life, and you have to be mentally prepared to take this exam because it's not just a regular exam. You're taking this exam, it's the gold standard of this profession, and so you are being, it's a privilege to be a CFP. It's a privilege to be in the homes and the lives of clients, and so you have to take that very seriously. So the next time I took the exam, I literally shut off everything. I'm grateful for my husband because he took over everything. I was like, honey, I'm going to work, and I'm studying. That's it. He was like, all right, I got you. And so I passed the exam. I studied for like 6 months straight and no social life, but it happened. But yeah, it's not an easy exam, but it's well worth it.
Great. I commend all of you for the determination and finding the time. And, you know, one thing I want to follow up, but when Brittany talked about working and studying and so forth, there's more than, you know, going back to college. There are two types of mm-hmm. Ways to get all the educational requirements. One is in a degree program mm-hmm. like Rianca did, but there's also registered programs, there are online programs that you can take. So there's lots of ways to, you know, get the education while you're working. Because a lot of people are working when they then decide to go back and get their CFP. So mm-hmm. that's an important thing for people thinking about it to know. So, okay, so let's talk about, you got that CFP, you passed the exam, you're ready to now sit in front of clients. As a certified financial planner. What was that like the first time? What did it feel like advising that first client? Maybe for some of you, you were advising clients beforehand, but in any case, what did it feel like to be advising clients?
Yeah, I'll start. I was advising clients prior to me getting the CFP, but I'd say one of the proudest moments I had post getting the CFP was meeting with a prospective client who told me she had only met with me because I was a CFP. She had declined other people that had pursued her to, you know, this was a person who didn't really come from wealth, but she had inherited wealth, and the first piece of advice that she got was, you don't need to speak to anyone unless they're a certified financial planner. So just to be able to walk into that meeting proud, knowing that I had kind of already beat most of the competition, I was like, this is good. And over my career, I've had that happen probably a dozen times so far.
Great. I would also add, for me, it was like such a proud moment, and I felt a lot more confidence, you know, with those following meetings. I had worked with clients for a few years before. But I think one of the most exciting things for me was actually being able to like put that mark everywhere, you know, yeah. Like update my business cards, my website, put my profile page on the CFP board, the FPA, you know, profile pages, and
the tattoo.
You should only work with CFPs. That was basically what I started saying every time I talked to somebody. You should only work with a CFP, and here's why. But it was because of the, you know, the honor and the prestige that the designation comes with. And it's nice to be able to educate people about this designation, because some do ask for it, but a lot of people still don't really know what it means and how it's different than just a financial professional in general. So I actually enjoy educating the people that I meet with, oh, here's what a CFP is, and here's the difference, and it's not a good or bad thing, it's just is, you know, mm-hmm, so. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I remember when we were doing the WIN research and we had focus groups, and what really struck me in one of the focus groups, several of the women CFPs, and I kind of put this question to you as millennials, these were younger women who had their CFPs, and they said, having that CFP enabled me to talk to older clients. And as CFPs, we often are dealing with older clients. Retirement's a big issue. Did you find that? I mean, did it give you the confidence to, you know, be a young advisor, be a young professional, but still feel that you held your own with older individuals? Does that ring a bell for any of you?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Okay. And so when, you know, we have the CFP, again, very proud moment. You know, as soon as I got the marks, you know, you just said a little higher and, you know, talked a little prouder and just like, you know, I know what I'm talking about. You know, so the confidence exude, it was definitely there. But then also being a millennial and, you know, much younger than, you know, the clients who are sitting across from the table, I remember after, you know, launching my firm, one of my very first clients was a 60-year-old couple. And, you know, I'm speaking to him on the phone and like, yeah, so have you checked out my website? And he's like, yeah, I have. I'm like, okay, well, you know, I'm just trying to like, hey, you know, like, you know, I work with millennials, 20s, 30s, and 40s. And he's like, oh, yes, I know. And he was like, I'm looking specifically for you because you're younger and because you're a CFP. And, you know, from my experience, my estate planning attorney has passed away. My tax advisor has passed away. And now I just want to be able to work with an advisor that will be able to outlive me. Outlive me, and then also pass the knowledge and just family, the institutional family knowledge that they're sharing with me, and pass it on to their children. And so he hired me, and you know, it's been a really great relationship.
I don't know. I like my doctors young. I think we've got a new angle here.
Yeah,
this is great. So, okay, we're getting to the. We've got to sandwich in another really important topic, and that is really to talk about your gender, your youth, your racial heritage, and how that has helped. And I want each of you to answer this one. How has that helped, or how has that mattered? Has it mattered in your work, in your professional practice?
Yeah, for me, going into, I work in the wealth management business, and going into that space, a lot of my clients do not look like me. And for that reason, I had some concerns going into that space. Like, I wonder if they're going to, what they're going to think of me, or am I going to be deemed qualified enough? And sidebar, I mean, that's where the CFP really helped out a lot. But over the years, here's how I would explain it best. You know, we as human beings, we look for a connection, and we find it easy to identify those when it's related to golf or where we went to school together, or if you grew up on a farm versus in the city. Those things are easily acknowledged and easily accepted. But I think every client deserves to work with someone who they believe understands their unique situation. I met with a client yesterday where I'll spare you the example for the sake of time, but another professional had explained bonds to him and had used an analogy or a reference. I explained bonds to him and had used a similar reference but used different terms. And he laughed, and I was like, what? And he's like, you explained that to me. And when this guy explained it, I didn't know what he was talking about. You used a term that I thought maybe I only used that term and my family only used that term. And it was just a prime example of, sometimes there's some uniqueness to where you're from, to who you are, and our clients deserve to have professionals in the space that represent that.
Great. Brittany, how about you?
Yeah, so I actually got my CFP designation when I was 26 years old, and I was a woman. I looked really young, and I was in the finance industry. So, you know, I did actually become aware of the lack of women specifically in the industry kind of a few years in, like right away, because I was really one of the only few women at my company. And a lot of times I would go to these conferences and I was actually the advisor who qualified in terms of, you know, production to be at the conference. And actually everybody thought my significant other was the one who won, you know, and I was like, no, it's me. But, and then, you know, just working with a lot of couples, I would always walk away from meetings and think, oh, the woman always talks to me. Like, the woman is always asking me at the end of the meeting, am I going to be okay? Like, didn't really care about all the nuts and bolts and standard deviation and beta. It was like, am I going to be okay? Is my family going to be okay? And am I going to have enough money to do what I want to do? And so I really started to study that, women and money. And Eleanor, you were such a huge mentor for me. And, you know, I saw that there was just this lack of women specifically in the industry. And then also just being a young woman, I thought, well, hey, I can do it. I want to just go after this niche. And actually, that's what my company is. I have a company called Financially Wise Women. So I am a woman. I help women. And I really like to sit on the same side of the table and say, I'm just like you. I understand what you're going through. I want to be able to explain this complex financial world to you in a way that's easy so you really understand it and you feel confident moving forward with it. And it's very fulfilling for me. And recently I've done a lot more work just in terms of being Hispanic and a minority and really helping more Hispanic women understand money. And I think that's a huge part of just me honoring myself and where I come from. And it's kind of like this beautiful full circle of where I started from and where I am now, and being able to say, yeah, I actually represent all these things, young, woman, minority, and be part of this campaign is a very exciting, it's an exciting time.
Right. Mm-hmm. Rianca, you've called yourself the triple threat.
I have not. I did not call myself that. I think actually Kate Healy called me that.
Oh, there you go. But we loved it when we heard it, because of course Rianca being biracial, mm-hmm. being a millennial, being a woman, and Brittany, you're a triple threat as well.
Yeah.
So, but tell us a little bit about how that has shaped your practice and your professional, you know, your professional mm-hmm. practice and how you work, and has it been helpful?
Yeah, so very similar experience, similar to Brittany and Justin from the client perspective of just being able to, you know, from a cultural perspective, be able to speak the same language, whether it's money, whether it's finances, or just about different cultural issues of, you know, having to take care of other family members or friends, depending on your community. And, you know, when we walk through the door, when we sit at a client's table, you know, at the table with a client, we do not wipe away who we are. If anything, we're bringing that to the table as well. And so we are an extension of our community. I am an extension of my community. And so I wear that very proudly. So from a client perspective, that's who I am. That's what I bring to the table. And then also from a profession, just example, just, you know, when I do have a seat at the table, when I am afforded these platforms like the CFP Pro campaign, you know, not shying away from talking about the issues that matter, so that we can get more women, so that we can get more people of color, and then also young professionals in this profession.
Great. Well, I have a lot more questions, but we've got to the point where I want to open it up to questions from you all here and to our webcast listeners or viewers. So we'll take a few questions, and I also want to say for those who are viewing the webcast that if we don't get to your questions, we will be responding after the event. So thank you all.
Any takers for the first?
I'm coming.
Clearly, you each were interested in finance while you were in college, but were you aware of the CFP designation at that point? At what point did you say, this is a goal I want to accomplish?
So I actually stumbled upon the CFP program at Virginia Tech, and it wasn't until I took it was an elective course of personal finance, and in that class, I learned about credit scores, credit reports, disability insurance, life insurance, and my mind was literally blown. I'm like, why are we not teaching this why is this not a required course? And so I became the personal finance, person on campus, the guru. All the students came to me because I kept sharing knowledge and, you know, kept going back to my community and sharing that knowledge. Went to my advisor and said, hey, I want to take more classes like this. And they said, well, did you know that there's actually an entire curriculum for this? I was like, sign me up. I'll switch majors. I'll do whatever I need to so I can, you know, take the CFP track. And so that's how it happened for me.
Okay, we have one webcast. Oh.
I was actually a little bit different. I actually didn't ever know about a financial planner in general. I studied business economics, and actually I think it was mentioned earlier, I always kind of equated finance to like boring analytical and math. And even though I was really good at math, I knew I wanted to help people, and I'm way too like social and entrepreneur minded to just like sit behind a calculator all day. So it wasn't until I talked to my college counselor, and she said, why don't you accept this offer to become a financial advisor? And I was like, well, I don't even know what that means. And she goes, well, give it a shot, you might like it. And so I did. And actually it was in that first year that I learned more about financial planning as a profession and heard about the CFP designation.
I was not informed about the designation when I was a student. I kind of had in my head, when you're in college, it's a mixture of what you feel versus what people tell you you ought to do. And so in my head, I think it was go to undergrad and then go get your MBA, and then something good will happen after that. And when I became informed about the CFP, it sent me on a different trajectory. That was absolutely what I needed to do.
And here I was an English major, and they hadn't yet even invented the CFP back then, but I found it, and it's been a perfect platform for all of my interests as well. So we have a webcast question. Will we be able to share this campaign on our social media? And the answer is emphatically yes. We're going to be, you can use the hashtag CFP Pro on Twitter and Instagram. And you can also go to the website, which is cfppro.org. So please take to your Twitter. Please take to your Instagram. Please share this on your social media.
So first of all, I'd like to thank you for sharing your stories. It's been very informative to see how, at a young point in your career, you've been so successful. And so in alignment with that, I'd like to understand how you're utilizing your CFP designation to focus on working with millennials, and overall what your strategy is by targeting that market, which typically hasn't been an area where a lot of our professionals are gearing their time. So thank you.
I can start that one off. So in the space I work in, it's a high net worth business. So it's not frequent that we have millennials as people who are prospective clients. But I'll do a plug for one of my friends. In the video, there is a place called The Gathering Spot, and there's a scene where I'm opening the door, and it's a really unique place in Atlanta. It's like a country club or your typical kind of city club, members only sort of deal. But it's specifically geared toward millennials, a lot of young tech people, a lot of startups, a lot of people in young politicians and such. And so that's a place that I frequent, and I meet a lot of people who are, a lot of time they're on the brink of becoming wealth level clients, and those who are not there and still need help, there's just a big referral source of, hey, here's someone that might be able to work with you, here's someone that might be more suited for you. So places like that, I think millennials are becoming very creative in networking and engaging with people. So that's how I use my CFP designation.
Mm-hmm. So for me, over the span of my career, just working with wealth management firms and seeing, similar to Justin, how there's just, you know, from a business perspective, it just doesn't make sense to bring on someone who doesn't have $1 million, so to say, especially if you have the AUM model and or assets under management for those live streamers. the assets under management model, it just doesn't make sense from a business perspective. And so I found, you know, a calling, a passion to work with my generation. And so my firm is actually set up to be able to serve millennials, and where my fee structure is not such that it's based on an AUM. So I don't care how much money you have, but I do have a minimum annual retainer. And so those I find who are ready to work with me are who I call the Henrys, the high earners, not rich yet, where they have, you know, the income, whether it's a one or two income household, especially in this DC area, you know, they have the income, but they may not have accumulated the wealth. Well, let me help you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, three of you. It was terrific. You all talked about how you learned about CFP and how you get into the profession. So part of the mission of the center is to build a more diverse and sustainable workforce. So my question to you is, if you're sitting in the shoes of the center, how do we expand the pipeline? How do we get the message out to get more more diverse people, more women, more people of color into the pipeline so they hear about this before you did? What advice would you give the center?
I just want to pair that with a webcast question that's along the same lines, and it's a great question. It's for firms that recognize the challenge of bringing on younger, more diverse planning talent but aren't sure where to start in addressing it. What would your recommendations be?
I would say, one, a college campus tour, you know, to go visit colleges and educate students about this as a profession. I mean, it's great that you took that as your degree, but like me, if it was something on campus where I was able to learn about financial planning, I mean, that would be amazing to teach more individuals just that this is a real profession, that they can succeed. And then I think in terms of helping advisors who have the businesses, I mean, we learned there's a lot of people retiring in this industry, and if we're not giving them more resources, more education to hire and train new talent, I think it is a huge problem. So I feel like as a business owner, to, you know, bring me additional resources so I have the ability to train new, younger CFPs to join my company, join me, and help me as a business owner so I don't have to devote so much time and energy to all of that. That would be nice, because I think that's one of the biggest reasons they're not doing it, is because they don't have the bandwidth to take on a junior partner or train somebody from the ground up.
Mm-hmm. I'd add that I think the videos are a phenomenal start. I just think if this had been, imagine if this had been a several page article in a magazine, or just things are consumed so differently now. Mm-hmm. These a 2 minute video, or the 30-second or even the 15-second, those things, when they just show up on someone's email or social media sites, I mean, I think first you just kind of capture the attention, and then the pursuit goes from there.
Mm-hmm. Great, yeah. Well, I think we're at the end. I will say, you know, our Wynn Council at one point, we talked about a reality show that featured, you know, we have the lawyers, we have the doctors. Why not a reality show to show CFPs? And I would say that what we saw today really is better than. Much better acting. But really sort of kind of opens up the world of what it is and have the life, and you play guitar. Is that right?
I'm a beginner.
Keep working at it. So I want to thank you all very, very much, and assure our webcast listeners, still some great questions we will be answering for you. And thank all of you for participating today.
Well, I must say, I love the CFP swagger of our three CFP pros. Amazing. Great stories. So it's now my responsibility to bring this event, the launch of the I Am a CFP Pro campaign, to a close. But I want to also assure you that the professional pride and the passion that you have seen and heard in the stories here today from these three remarkable young and diverse CFP professionals doesn't end here. We've got a lot more to do. These are stories and messages that deserve to be shared and spread, and that's why all of you are here. At least that's what we ask of you, as well as those of you that are streaming live and on the webcast. Not just to glorify Rianca, Brittany, and Justin, because their story is pretty remarkable, but to open wide the doors of the financial planning profession to all who aspire to become CFP professionals, with the real aim to help American families and their own communities set and achieve financial goals and look to their futures with a sense of security and confidence, because that's what we do as CFP professionals, and that's why the public should be facing off with a CFP professional when it comes to their finances. This campaign is meant to demonstrate how three individuals of different gender, color, experience, and backgrounds have found their own unique path and their own professional identity in financial planning, and thereby encourage those who they may inspire to also consider following in their path. So this campaign also provides a call to action for each of you with us today to celebrate this launch, for the young people that are in the room, and for all of you young people who are considering their career path, this as a career path or a career path in general, and just getting started, we would direct you to our campaign website. We've mentioned it a few times, cfppro.org. It's real easy, where the videos will be available, as well as information regarding requirements to become a CFP professional, and also some very helpful resources to get you there. For all of our educators, we have a special toolkit, and it's used to promote CFP certification, not only to students, but also prospective students. So it's a great way to inform those that you're looking to join your programs. These very same resources would be extremely helpful for firms, particularly large financial services firms, to promote the CFP certification to employees. For the CFP professionals here today, or for all those CFP professionals you know or work with, I hope you and your associates might be inspired to share your story, just as Brittany and Justin and Rianka have done today, and share it on our website and through social media such as Twitter and Instagram, or Insta, as my stepdaughter calls it. Be sure to tag your stories with the hashtag CFPPro. As we've seen today, our stories powerfully connect rather than separate us, and this is so important. As we find ourselves relating to another's experience and see in their journey the potential for ourselves, I have to say I was amazed as I was listening to all three of you. It reminded me of my own experience, and I'm sure many in the room had the same feeling. I mean, I think I was 25 when I started thinking about the CFP. It didn't find me. I had to find it. It wasn't popular then. I'm now 55, and it really, really framed and served as the foundation for pretty much everything that I do. So, again, I'm just one example. There are many examples. This is a whole lot more than just a career. It's really a calling at the end of the day. And you can see that in all three of you. So I want to thank Brittany, Rianka, and Justin, and everyone on the Center for Financial Planning team who brought I Am a CFP Pro to life today. And I also want to tell everyone viewing the webcast, the webcast recording will be available shortly after the event on the same page you are now viewing. And finally, I want to thank each of you in the room and listening for your interest, your support, and hopefully for sharing today's messages beyond today with your colleagues, your friends, your communities, and your families. So now please join me. We're going to have a reception. We hope you'll all come. And I really think this is certainly worth celebrating, don't you? Cheers.